Welcome to the Capital Gearing Ratio course under the Wall Street Mojo platform. In this course, we'll try to understand what is capital gearing ratio and what is it means. So this ratio is basically an indicator of capital structure of a company or an entity. It shows the ratio of owners or shareholders' capital to the borrowed capital. So in simple terms, it is basically the ratio of equity to debt. The calculation of capital gearing ratio is very simple. It's actually the equity capital of a company by the debt capital of the company. So we'll take up an illustration of the calculation, how it is carried out. Now let us go through the calculation methodology of capital gearing ratio. So let's put down the formula: capital gearing ratio . So here let's have it, what that is, total owner's capital or shareholders' equity, especially in case of a company, and divided by, so let's put it this, and we have it over here, total debt capital or total amount of borrowings. So we can see formula is very simple for capital gearing ratio. It is basically the total owner's capital or a shareholder's equity in case of a company is divided by the total debt capital or total amount of borrowings. So this is broadly the formula of the capital gearing ratio. Now we'll take up an illustrative numbers or balance sheet and try to calculate the capital gearing ratio for easy understanding. Now let us try to construct an illustrative balance sheet and from that we will try to calculate the capital gearing ratio for easy understanding. So illustrative balance sheet, let's for example, it is fixed assets, and let us do it for 2 years, year one and year two. So we have fixed assets, current assets and total assets. And now let us put the numbers over here, illustrative numbers. For fixed assets, say let us have 1250. Let it be in absolute terms. And say current assets, let's put it 450 and 510. So total assets, for example, it is coming. So now we know total assets as 1700 and 1835 for year 2. Now let us construct the liability side. Say for example, we have a long term liability and a short current liability. Long term liability. So we have a long term liability and a current liability, and total comes to as a total liability for this section. So now let us put the figures over here. So a long term liability, let us have the figures as 50 and 275 for year 2. So let's have 175, 195. Let's have the total over here. See, long term liability plus current liability, this. And let us move it to this cell also. So 425 and 470. So we have now over here net assets. That is C is equal to A minus B. Let's put it over there for easy understanding. That is total assets minus total liabilities. And we have preference capital. Preference capital means a capital raised with a fixed return, that is with a preference dividend at a particular rate. So let's have it over here, and the figures, let's put it over here. Total net assets, the formula would be assets minus the liability, and over here, year 2, it is 1365, and let's have a constant preference share capital of 375, and over here also 375. The next portion would be equity shareholders capital. So equity shareholders capital would be, let's put it over here, equity shareholders capital, that is CD. So equity shareholders capital would be the total net assets and minus the preference share capital, net assets of the company minus the preference share capital, that is over here 900, and for year 2 it will be 990, basically net assets minus preference share capital. So in other ways also, to the shareholders capital would match with the pure equity capital and the reserves of the company. So the total equity shareholders capital is also broken down into pure equity capital, which is, say, for example, 650 for both the years, and reserves which gets accumulated over the years. For year 1 in this case it is 250, and say year 2 it is 340. So we now have the balance sheet constructed, an illustrative one. Now we'll move on to see capital gearing ratio calculation from this illustrative balance sheet. So let's try to calculate the capital gearing ratio, in absolute terms. And the first would be the total equity capital or equity shareholders capital . Then it will be total fixed cost capital, that is total fixed cost capital, and finally the ratio. So let's pull the figures of the total equity share capital, shareholders capital, from the illustrative balance sheet. So this over here, we are linking it, and over here it will be the debt capital plus the preference shareholders capital. So basically the fixed capital, fixed cost capital, total fixed cost capital, that is preference share capital plus the total long-term liability. So it is over here. So as per the formula over here, so ratio would be 900 divided by 625 over here, and similarly 990 divided by 650 over here. And if we reduce it as per the mathematical terms, it will be 9 and divided by 6.25, and over here it will be 9.9 divided by 6.5. So this is the pure ratio over here, and if we carry out this calculation, then we'll get the actual numbers. So the actual ratio in numbers is 1.44 and 1.52. So what it means is the equity share capital is 1.44 times of the fixed share capital, and in year 2 the equity share capital is 1.52 times of the total fixed cost capital, that is 990 divided by 650. So this is in pure number terms. We can also have capital gearing ratio in percentage terms as well. So the percentage term, it is simple, it is 100 divided by 625, and we have 1.44 this, and converted into percentage we have 144%. So we now know the capital gearing ratio in ratio terms. In absolute numbers it is 1.44 and 1.52, whereas if we can convert it into percentage terms, that means the equity shareholder capital is 144% of the fixed cost capital for year 1, and similarly 152% for the year 2. Now we shall do a short analysis of capital gearing ratio. So capital gearing ratio is also known as financial leverage. Financial leverage at proper levels helps expanding the business. That is, a proper mix of debt with equity capital in a company or in a business helps the business to grow with due to the benefit of expanded capital. So we have a high capital gearing ratio. That is when the situation is when the entity is having high debt in its book of accounts. Similarly, we have a situation as low capital gearing ratio. So that is when the entity is having high equity and a low debt in their finances. I will do a short comparison between two firms, say firm A, to understand high capital gearing and low capital gearing situations. Firm A and say firm B. And so we have put over here firm A, firm B, and equity owner capital A, that is term as signified as A, and total interest bearing capital, that is debt and preference shareholders capital, as B. So here we will write capital gearing ratio is A divided by B. So let's take up an illustrative number. Say for here it is equity or owner capital as 300, and over here for example we have 400, and similarly interest bearing capital over here say 500, and over here it is 300. So the capital gearing ratio would be say 300 by 500, that is 3 by 5 over here, and in this case it is 4 divided by 3. So let's put it in all together over here. So it comes in one line, that is 3 by 5 and 4 by 3. Now we'll try to understand what are the implications for an high geared entity. So over here we'll try to understand 3 points. The first one would be the debt servicing has to be carefully monitored, since equity capital is less, owner's capital is less, and it is depending upon the amount that is generated in the business. So the fixed cost capital is more, so it has to be carefully monitored because there is no other fallback scenario over here. So the next point is any additional borrowing. If this highly geared firm requires an additional borrowing, so it becomes restricted, the options become restricted, and bankers and financial institutions are reluctant to lend. They already see that the company has high fixed cost capital against their owner's contribution, that the owner's capital. So in case of default, there is no other way to realize the fixed lent amount. So there is a lot of reluctancy in further lend. And finally, the cost of borrowing becomes high in case of highly geared entity, and in turn it further impacts the overall financials of the entity. So if somehow the amount is borrowed, it will be coming at increased cost, that is interest rate would be higher than the normal case, and it will further impact the overall financials, that it will take away more amount of the profit generated out of the business. So the remaining amount for the shareholders and overall business development would be reduced. So this will impact the overall financials of the entity. So we now see the total analysis over here. The main 3 points: debt servicing is to be monitored, additional borrowings becomes difficult, and cost of borrowings becomes high. And over here now we come to an end of the capital gearing ratio course. Thank you.